All right, guys, today's lesson is 1.7, and we're going to go over perimeter, circumference, and area. And if we look in our book, our goal today is to be able to find perimeters of rectangles and squares and circumferences of circles, which is the outside edge, and also to find the areas of rectangles, squares, and circles. So remember, what you see right here is what I want you to put in your whisk. And be keeping those because those count as your class notes. All right, so I want to go over these a little quickly. You might need to pause the video to write these formulas down. The perimeter of a square, measuring the outside length. We know that all four sides of a square are equal. So you could just say the perimeter is equal to 4 times whatever the outside length is, the sum total of all the sides. Okay, if we take a look at the area of a square, since all four sides are equal, when you find the area, you've got one side times the other side. So the area of a square, you can just say the side squared is their area of the square. Take a look at the perimeter of a rectangle. Since rectangles have two equal heights and two equal lengths or widths or whatever you want to call it, we need two of each. So the perimeter of this one you would label 2b plus 2h's, or you could even write it this way, two times b plus h. That's the perimeter of a rectangle, the outside length. All right, now the area of a rectangle is the base times the height. That is the area formula. All right, if we get into circles, the circumference of a circle is the distance around the outside, kind of like a perimeter for square and rectangles. And the circumference formula, using pi, which we will narrow down to 3.14, the circumference equals pi times the diameter. The diameter is the length all the way across. Or you could say it's equal to 2 pi times the radius. Now, radius is just halfway across the circle, so that's why you would need the 2 in there to get the diameter length. Either way is just fine. That's the circumference of a circle. And the area of a circle, we're going to use pi again. The area of the circle is equal to pi times the radius squared, pi r squared. That's a symbol for times, not an x. So anyway, pi r squared is the area of a circle. And since we know these things, we're going to move over to our book and do a few examples. And I expect to see these examples in your whisks to show me that you were able to work them out. We'll talk about this one and then the green check for understanding I want to see in your whisk. We're not going to do it yet. So this question talks about the pool, a pool being 15 feet wide and 20 feet long, and it has a 3-foot deck surrounding it. And you want to build a fence around the deck, and it's asking how much fencing you're going to need. Well, we have to include that 3 feet. So the width of the pool deck is going to be this 15 feet plus 3 on this side and 3 on that side, which is going to equal 21. And the length of the pool is going to be the 20 feet of the pool plus the 3 on this side and the 3 on that side. So that's going to be a total of 26. And since I need to find the perimeter, I need 2 of each of those, since it's a rectangle. And when I fill everything in, my perimeter is going to be 94 feet. So using this information, I want you to work this problem out. And I'll bring it. We've got 2 of them here. They go with each other. I want you to figure out both of these. Suppose you want to frame a picture that is 6 inches by 7 inches with a 1/2 inch wide frame. Find the perimeter of the picture. And then you're going to find the perimeter of the outside edge of the frame. So first the perimeter of the picture, and then you can think of it this way, the picture with the outside edge of the frame included. So pause the video and do that, and check back for the answer. All right, hopefully you did that, and as you did your figuring, when you did just the picture, you should have come up with 26 inches for the outside edge perimeter of just the picture. That'd be 2 sixes and 2 sevens added together. But when you include the half inch for the frame, which is what the second part wants, hopefully you notice that's going to add an inch to your lengths and your widths. So that's going to be 4 inches added altogether. So 26 and 4 make 30. And we'll check our answers, and we got those right. So hopefully you worked that out right, and you'll show me that in your whisk. All right, we're going to move down and do a little bit of finding the circumference of a circle using the formula that the circumference equals pi times the diameter, or you could say 2 pi times the radius, because the radius is half the diameter. So if you were looking for a circumference of a circle in terms of pi, find it to the nearest tenth. And if this circle was the one we were talking about over here, it is 12 inches in diameter. So you would say 12 times pi, which works out right here. We're going to round it to the nearest tenth, and that gives us 37.7 inches. So knowing that, you are going to work this one out. It's two parts in your whisk, and I want to see it. And you are looking for the circumference of a circle with the radius of 18 meters in terms of pi. So that means you're not going to multiply it out. You're not going to multiply the 3.14. You're just going to write pi instead of multiplying it out. Then the second one, you're going to find the circumference of a circle with a diameter of 18 meters to the nearest tenth. And that means you are going to multiply out the 3.14 this time. Also notice the difference in the two questions. This is the radius, and this is the diameter. So remember that. Pause the video and then check for your answers. All right, when you work those out, hopefully you found that the circumference of a circle with a radius of 18 meters in terms of pi is 36 pi. And then when you found the circumference of a circle with a diameter of 18 meters and you multiplied it out using pi to the nearest tenth, you came up with 56.5 meters. If you did not, you need to check your math and your formula. All right, so let's move down and talk about finding the perimeter in the coordinate plane. This one's gonna be a little bit different. We're gonna have to use our formulas that we've talked about in the past. If you notice this triangle, we're asked to find the perimeter of this triangle with these coordinates. So if we just use our ruler postulate, for AB, you can plug in the numbers for your x value here, since this is on the x-axis. And that would be 5, take away negative 1, which is going to be the absolute value of that is 6. So there's your length of this side. And you could do that simple formula for this one as well for your y-axis coordinates, which is 6 and negative 2. And when you do those and you find take those away and you find the absolute value, that one's going to be 8. So this one is 6 and this one is 8. This is the one we have to use our distance formula for. And when you plug in the coordinates for x, 5 and negative 1, subtract those and square them. Do the same for your y, just like we learned the other day. 6 and negative 2, subtract those and square them. Work all that out and you get the distance between the coordinate A and C as being 10. And since we're finding the perimeter, we're going to add all three of those up, 6, 8, and 10, and we get 24 as the perimeter of this triangle. Now, knowing that, I'm going to ask you to do this one. Now, this is going to be a little bit tough, and I'm going to show you how I work this out. But before I do that, I want you to try it. Please promise me that you'll try this. Graph this on your paper with these four coordinates, okay? KLMN has these vertices. K is negative 3, negative 3. L is 1, negative 3. M is 1, 4. And N is negative 3, 1. Graph those and see if you can find the perimeter of this before you look and see what I did. All right, hopefully you paused the video and you did that. So I'm going to scroll down and show you what I did. These are the points of this problem we just looked at right here. So I graphed them. This is N, this is K, this is L, and this is M. And when I graphed it, I noticed, oh, that's a freaky little figure there. But I noticed that if I filled this in, I have a square at the bottom and a triangle at the top. And I know how to do those two. I know how to find the perimeter. Now, when I find the perimeter of the square, I am not going to count this top line because that's not part of my perimeter. My perimeter is only the outside edge. So if I use my ruler postulate, I can find the length between N and K, K and L and my new point right here, 1, 1, where the square stops. And when I add all of those up, the three sides of my square equals 12 units. Also using my ruler postulate, I can find the length between M and this new point that I made. And that is 3 units. Now, this little booger right here, I can use my distance formula for. So let me scroll down and show you just a little bit here. Hopefully we can see it all. My distance formula says if I take my two x coordinates, which is 1 and negative 3, subtract those and square them. Take my two y coordinates, 4 and 1, subtract those and square them. Work all that out. I'm going to get the square root of 25, which is 5. So this distance right here is 5. And if I take the 5, the 4 right here, the 4 here, the 4 here, and the 3 right here, add them all up, I get 20 units. So hopefully when you worked out finding the perimeter to this problem here on the coordinate plane, you got 20 units. Yay! I did too. But I already had it worked out and knew I was correct. All right. Well, look at there. I didn't mean to do that. I'm so good at drawing those extra lines. All right. So that's the tricky one. Let's move on ahead now. And I'm going to turn the page and we're going to get to finding the area of a rectangle. Now you know when you find the area, you multiply the base times the height. This question here says you're designing a rectangular banner for the front of a museum. The banner will be 4 feet wide and 7 yards high. How much material do you need? Hopefully you notice that you were given two different measurements, feet and yards. And it looks like it'll probably be easiest to change these yards in the feet to find my answer. And there are 3 feet per yard. So multiply 7 times 3 and you get 21. So now you can multiply the base times the height, which would be 4 times 21, and get the area of 84 square feet. I want you to do this problem in your WISC. And it uses, I'm going to move this right over here because it uses the same problem. It says find the area of the banner in example 4, which is this one right here, by first changing all the units to yards. Since we changed the yards to feet, now you're changing the feet to yards. So figure that out before you press play again. All right, hopefully when you did that, you discovered that the area would be 9 1/3 yards squared, if you did it correctly. And that is exercising your algebra skills. We will practice some of those in class. All right, again, another finding the area of a circle. You have to remember that the area of a circle is pi r squared. That's why we wrote those formulas down. All right, this one says the diameter of a circle is 10 inches. Find the area in terms of pi. That means we're not going to multiply it through. We're just going to say pi for 3.14. All right, we need to know the radius, and that's half the diameter, so that's 5. And if we plug that in, pi times 5 squared would be 25 pi. So the area of the circle is 25 pi square inches. All right, I want you in your WISC to figure this problem out. There's two parts. First, you're going to find the diameter of a circle. You know that the diameter of a circle is 5 feet. So find the area in terms of pi. And then part B is the same diameter, but this time you're actually going to find the area to the nearest tenth. That means you're going to multiply out using 3.144 pi. So work that out in your WISC. Press pause before you listen to me next. All right, hopefully you did that. And when you found the area in terms of pi with the diameter being 5 feet, you got 25/4 pi square feet. And when you actually work that out and you put 3.14 in place for pi, you will get 19.6 square feet. Yay! Got that one too. All right. So, the next thing I want you to put in your WISC, let me scroll down here, are these two postulates. They're pretty self-explanatory. 1-9 says if two figures are congruent, that means they're equal, then their areas are equal. Hope so. That means they're matching. And then postulate 1-10 says the area of a region is the sum of the area of its non-overlapping parts. I do want you to write these down, so you may have to press pause, but I'm going to show you an example of what that postulate 1-10 means. It's kind of weird. So if you have like a weird shape like this one, it's irregular. When you find the area, you can't just use one formula for it. You're going to have to divide this shape into sections that you're able to find the area of. So we divided this weird shape here into a rectangle, a smaller rectangle, and a square. And we're going to use our area formulas for rectangles and squares, then add all of them up to get the total area, which is 24 square centimeters. That's what that postulate 110 is talking about. So if we take a look at this example dealing with postulate 110, it asks you, look at this shape. It's been separated in different ways. And choose the way that would allow you to find the area of this irregular shape. So you decide right now. Press pause if you have to before I tell you which one it is. Hopefully you noticed how neatly this one is divided into three separate squares. And we can easily find the area of three squares. So this one is the one it should be separated into. Let me check that. Yay, we got that one right too. All right, guys, I know this was a long lesson, but remember, one whisk is usually for two separate days and you won't have one the next day. I do expect to see all of this in your notes, and I hope you have a good rest of the evening, and I'll talk to you soon.